Today is Laetare Sunday. It is the fourth Sunday of Lent. It's the middle point in Lent. By tradition, it's a point when we lighten up just a little bit in our Lenten devotion, because we can see Easter on the horizon on this day in churches that are both rich and ritualist. They change out their purple vestments for pink ones, which they prefer to call rose because it sounds classier, I guess. The organ is allowed to be played for something other than accompanying singing. There can be flowers in the church. There are a variety of things we do to say, look, we're making progress. And in the spirit of lightening up, I thought today I would ask our curate to explain to us the theology of snakes on sticks. He doesn't seem inclined to do that, though, so perhaps I won't do that because I didn't really warn him ahead of time. Instead, I will ask you to pull out the piece of paper that is in your bulletin, or if you are joining us online, hopefully it is available on the screen. This was which was opposite the sermon in the bulletin for this morning. And to give you a little backstory so you'll know why it isn't even telling you about this, the piece of the gospel that we hear this morning, the piece from the Gospel of John, is from the story called The Visit of Nicodemus to Jesus. This wealthy, powerful, influential man in Israel who has come to Jesus in the middle of the night is this charismatic young preacher who he really can't be seen going to see because there are reasons he wouldn't want to be seen doing this. But he's gone to talk to him about his own faith, the faith of Judaism, big questions he has for Jesus. And Jesus is responding to the questions Nicodemus has put out. And what we're hearing today is the response of Jesus to Nicodemus. So with that as a reason why this is important, what you have are two paintings of this scene by the painter Henry O'Tanner. You may or may not know Henry O'Tanner. He's one of my heroes. He was born in the mid-19th century in Pittsburgh, was the son of a Methodist bishop. He studied art in Philadelphia and was extremely talented, but because he was an African American late in the 19th century, he was unable to be successful as a painter here. So he did what any wise person in that situation would do at the time. He went to Paris, where he was immensely successful, very famous. One of his paintings is considered to be one of the national treasures of France. And among other things, he painted a lot of religious scenes. For some reason, that was part of his upbringing, and it continued to influence him, to inspire him through his career. And it's mainly for those paintings that he's well known now in the United States. You can go to the Art Museum in Philadelphia and see several of them there. The canvases are huge. He painted things that are feet wide by feet high, almost life-size people, very engrossing when you stand in front of them. At some point in his career, he became well enough known and successful enough that someone gave him a grant of money to go to North Africa and the Middle East to look at these places. And so in his later paintings of these scenes, we see him using the themes, the images he picked up on those trips, the themes of what those places look like. We get a little of that this morning in these pictures. The one on the bottom is actually the newer of the two, as he was becoming a little bit less sharp in his lines that he gave to people. You see Jesus and Nicodemus sitting on the roof of a house. Nicodemus is sitting on the ground as a student would have, and Jesus is sitting on a stool or on a chair, and they're speaking. It would appear a light is coming from behind Nicodemus toward Jesus, but that's about all we can tell. And really, it's hard to tell what anything else is in the scene other than just shapes. Compare that with the one on the top, which I think, frankly, is the more interesting of the two. Again, Nicodemus and Jesus are sitting on the roof. What fascinates me every time I see this picture is that Tanner has painted Nicodemus in such dull colors. He almost blends into the background. You almost don't see him there. The only source of color in the picture is the figure of Jesus and the light coming up the stairs. The light shines onto Jesus, but it also seems to be shining out of Jesus. Somehow from the upper part of his body and his face is a light that seems to radiate. That, I think, is all I need to say about these pictures. But with that as sort of an appetizer for your art appreciation for the day, let's talk a little about the gospel story from this morning. Certainly, John 3:16 is the most famous Bible verse. Even among those who are not Christians, you see it at football games. Apparently, people get it in tattoos You see it on cakes. People do needlepoint of it. It's everywhere in every imaginable form. And certainly there is nothing wrong with God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the end that all that believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But it's not enough. Taking just that one verse out of context doesn't give us the full story. We have to read what else Jesus says and hear what else Jesus says to really understand what Jesus is getting at. And once we do read what comes after that famous verse, not only are we edified, but questions begin to come up, I think. At least they do for me. What does it mean to believe? What is this belief thing, and how do I do it? What does it mean to come to the light? And what do I do once I'm in the light? And what is everlasting life, and should I want it? Let's think about those things just for a minute this morning, beginning with belief. We in the 21st century have a pretty clear idea of what it means to believe. We have a legal sense. You tell me something, and I do an analysis. I know some other information. I know what I know about you, whether you're a trustworthy source. I know whether this seems to fall in line with everything else that I already know or everything else I already believe. And I will decide whether I believe what it is you're telling me. It's a really from a head-up sort of process. And it involves our analysis of whether this fits with everything else, whether it makes sense to us, whether it's logical. That's not the kind of belief that Jesus is talking about. And I want to suggest to you it's not the kind of belief that we as Christians are called to have. I'll give you some examples of why that is the case. In my scientific career over the past 20 years, there's been a great deal of controversy and heat more than light around a series of studies that have been done about the efficacy of intercessory prayer. There's a group at Duke, there are a couple other groups around the world who've done these studies where they randomly assign people who are sick or who are recovering from surgery to be prayed for or not to be prayed for, with the goal of trying to see whether those who are prayed for heal more quickly. Now, I'll leave it to you to find what the results of those studies were if you want to go looking for them. But I'll say it created a lot of drama. All those who are on the scientific side are saying, these studies are nonsense. You're trying to prove that God exists. Ironically, all the people on the religious side are saying, these studies are nonsense. You're trying to prove that God doesn't exist. When in reality, that isn't at all what the studies are trying to prove because they can't. We will never prove in any empirical way with human means whether God exists or not. And in fact, even suggesting we could do that in a scientific way misses the point of belief. Example number one. Example number two. I could believe, truly believe, that I could go to the top of a very tall building, jump off, and save myself from smashing into the sidewalk halfway down. And in fact, I can go to the top of the high building and jump off. That part is true. But I can't save myself. I will crash onto the sidewalk. And every time I repeat the experiment, I will again fall and smash on the sidewalk. It being a scientific principle, you have to do it more than once to prove that it's true. My belief makes no difference in the outcome of this situation. It doesn't matter whether I think I can or not. I will always prove myself to be wrong. This also is not the kind of belief we're talking about here. Third example. Through my many years of my running career, I've dealt with days like today when there are puddles everywhere. And when I'm approaching a puddle, I have to decide whether I can jump over it or if I need to go around it. And I'm doing those calculations on the fly, literally, as I'm running up to this puddle. More often than not, I will decide, no, I really can't do it, and I'll run up on the grass, or I'll run out in the street and go around it. By my making that choice, I have proven myself right. I didn't jump over the puddle. I proved that I couldn't do it because I made that choice in that moment. My belief told me what the outcome would be, and I acted accordingly. And by acting in the way that I did, I closed off the possibility of anything else being possible. This also is not the faith or belief that Jesus desires for us. Another example that's closer, I think, to what Jesus has in mind, also from medical science, is antibiotics. I don't have to believe that penicillin works. All I have to do is swallow the pill. And then it will do its thing. The bacteria will do their thing. I'll get better or not for reasons that have nothing to do with whether I believe the drug works. Without any action on my part, something that is external to me, something that is outside of me, is acting in that case. And it makes no difference whether I believe it or not. It is true anyway. This, I think, is getting close to what it is Jesus means by belief. We will never be able to prove the existence of God. We will never be able to disprove the existence of God. And it makes no difference whether we try. Belief is about that thing that we can't know, that thing that we can't prove. And in that way, it's actually a little bit clearer than what we know, or what we believe by any other way that I've been talking to you about. To understand what I mean by that, consider also from medical science how many times over the past 20 years we have been told confidently that research shows that something is true. Oat bran will save your life, or whatever. And 6 months later, we discovered, oh no, it really doesn't do anything for you. Eat it, don't eat it, it doesn't really matter. Every time we think we know something, it turns out we just don't have quite enough information yet. The nature of belief is to be outside that system entirely, unconnected to what we know, and yet deeply connected to our relationship with God. So that's for belief. Then coming to the light. It is ironic, perhaps, that Nicodemus comes to Jesus in the dark looking for wisdom. And Jesus cannot resist speaking to Nicodemus in terms of light and darkness, sort of to remind him of the situation that he has come in. There's this powerful man who's looking for something important, but doesn't want to be seen looking for it. I don't want to suggest that it was bad that Nicodemus came to Jesus at all. Certainly, coming looking for wisdom is the first step toward acquiring it, toward internalizing it, toward allowing it to transform us. But I do want to suggest that it's not enough. It's not enough simply to come into the light and say, oh, isn't it wonderful to be in the presence of God? There's more. I think it calls us, once we are near the light, to expand it, to multiply it, to gather bits of light together in a way that increases the presence of God in the world, that increases the wholeness, the healing, the blessing of God in the world. I'll give you an example of this. Several years ago, I picked up the phone and I heard the voice of somebody I hadn't talked to since I'd left Charlotte many years before that. She was one of those people who collects people. She a wonderful soul who tries to do things for other people. And she was calling about someone she knew who was in the hospital, dying apparently of a lung infection that was likely caused by the unsanitary conditions in the apartment that this woman was living in. She was 40 years old. There's absolutely no reason why someone 40 years old should die of a lung infection. And the person who was calling me was indignant at this and decided to do something about it. So she talked to a lawyer to help get the conditions improved in the apartment and deal with all of that. She had talked to the person's relatives and friends to see who was going to advocate for this person in the hospital, because she was going to need an advocate. And she was calling me to ask if I knew any lung doctors. Well, as providence would have it, I had been gone from Charlotte for many years, but pulmonologist was the one category where I could actually name somebody. And I did. And as soon as we hung up, she picked up the phone and called that person, a complete stranger, cold, somehow sweet-talked him into going across town to see this woman in the hospital, which he did. And in fact, she did not die of the infection. what my friend on the phone was doing was gathering bits of light. This person who knew people, of course she knew people, in a variety of places and who could do different things, and bringing them together created a wholeness, a healing that would not have happened otherwise. She gathered light and multiplied light. Surely that is what you and I are meant to do also when we come into the light and walk in the light. Not simply be there, but do something about it. And then last is eternal life. I hasten to begin in talking about eternal life by making it very clear that we should all be aware that there are many, many people in this world who live in great pain, great sorrow, great misery of every imaginable kind. And to suggest that there is no such thing as a time and a place where God will make all of that right seems deeply unkind to me. It is a great source of comfort, of faith, to believe that in the end God wins, as Desmond Tutu says. And all that is wrong in this world, all that is broken in this world, will be repaired, restored, made right. There will be God's justice. But for a lot of us, I think that's not necessarily where we live our daily lives. Speaking only for myself, I go through my days with not so much huge sorrows as with little annoyances, little irritations. Every day of my life, I live with little irritations. And when I come to imagine eternal life as being living forever with every day having little irritations in it, it's possible for me to imagine for me to imagine saying, well, I don't really want that. So it's so important to recognize that although what we know of the world is all we have is our experience, that isn't necessarily what Jesus has in mind when he talks about eternal life. One of the themes that runs through the Gospel of John is that eternity begins now. The breaking of God into this world begins now. And so the restoration of things is already in progress. The kingdom of God has already come near to us. It isn't something that we wait for as a future possibility, but rather something that we come to perceive happening among us now. That tells us something important about eternal life. It begins with the way that we work to build the kingdom of God here and now. We have to believe that this life is going to continue to improve, and that it is within the power of God to inspire each one of us, indeed all of us together, to do something about that. To be living now as the community God desires, to be living now as the people God desires us to be. And in doing so, to chip away just a little bit more at that wall which the kingdom is already breaking into our present reality. Turning back to our pictures just quickly, I think what I have to hope for that one picture at the top is that Nicodemus went away from that encounter with Jesus a little more colored in, a little more fully realized as a person, a little more able to let the light of God shine out of him also. Surely that must be what each of us desires also. A little more light, a little more color, a little more ability to see what it is God desires for us. To live our lives with a little more blessing. God so loved the world that God sent God's only Son into the world that everyone should be saved. Amen.